think this might be your best session yet. The last session for today is interview with impact and the ethical job search. We have Alfonzo Alexander moderating the panel. And he will spend a few moments introducing our guests, Julie Peters and Elizabeth Wallin. So, hope you all enjoy.
Hello, it's me again. All I want to do is just briefly say a few things about each of our panelists and then give them an opportunity to give you a little more detail. Then I'll come back and share with you kind of the format of what we'll do for the rest of the time that we have together. To my immediate left is Julie Peters. And Julie serves as a U.S. Faculty Relations Manager for PricewaterhouseCoopers in the industry commonly known as PwC. She was a practicing CPA, is now inactive. She practiced on that side of the business for 7 years after graduating from Wittenberg University. And then in 1997, she made a career change and got into the recruiting side of the house. So for the last 13, 14 years, she's been interacting with faculty and individuals like you in terms of helping people get started in their career. She's a member and actively involved in AAA, which is the American Accounting Association, which is the professional association for accounting professors. And then they have a leadership group, APLG, which would be the department heads and so forth for those accounting departments across the country, and she's actively involved with them as well. So please welcome Julie Peters, if you will. And then to my far left is Elizabeth Wallin, and she serves as the Senior Tax Manager for Deloitte Tax, LLP. She is a CPA and has been practicing for over 10 years, but she also serves in a major role on the client services recruiting team, as well as she has spent the last 2 years as a campus recruiting manager for the Southeast practice. And she's based out of their Atlanta office, but works out of Pensacola, Florida. So again, she interacts with a lot of students on college campuses, as well as faculty and administration, to help individuals get started in their careers as well. That's all I'm going to say. Would like for them to have an opportunity to say hello and introduce themselves in their own fashion as well.
Not a fan of microphones, I'll just tell you right now. Hi, everyone. I'm really excited to be here. As far as any additional introduction, one of the things I've enjoyed most about the last 13, 14 years is the opportunity to interact with folks like you, and that's why I found campus recruiting to be really rewarding. So anything that we can do today to help answer questions or things you might want to talk about, definitely want to do that. Alfonso asked us to each share a unique experience we've had in interviewing candidates, so I'll throw one out for you. Similar to what's sort of going on outside today with the weather, there was a day where we were doing campus interviews at one of my schools that I was the main recruiter for, and there was a very nice young man, all dressed up in his interview suit, going to class, who got caught in a downpour trying to get across to the career services office. And the poor guy looked like a drowned rat by the time he got to us. The good news is it has a happy ending, because we did actually end up hiring this person. And the key was he never lost composure. He handled it well, you know, kind of just sort of took it in stride. And one of the things that we'll talk about throughout our comments today is when you're talking to an employer, they're envisioning you in their environment, working with their clients, encountering difficult situations, and they're trying to figure out how you're going to react. So the fact that this guy could pull it together and pull off a successful interview while he was dripping all around the interview room said a lot about him and his potential. So it had a happy ending.
See if this one's working. Yep. Not a fan of mics either. Kind of goes against my relaxed atmosphere, but I'll do the best I can here. I love working with you guys because you're going through such an exciting time in your life and making these big decisions. So what we're here to talk about is the whole interview process and how you navigate that ethically and not necessarily, we certainly hope you're not lying on your resume, but going through there and being open and honest with the people that you're interacting with and with yourself. So learning as much as you can about the positions that you're interviewing for and the companies, and then as much as you can about yourself during this time that you're making these decisions. My story that I'll kick off with has to do with that, and it's never too late. Don't feel like you're locked into something. We had, when I was doing interviews and internships, we had someone coming through the interview process who really wanted to do, they couldn't make up their mind. They're like, I don't know if I want audit. I don't know if I want tax. I have things I like about both. Can I split my internship? And my initial answer was, no, we don't do that. Typically, some firms do that. Deloitte doesn't usually do that. However, I knew that they wanted to do that. So they went ahead, picked audit, and started their internship in that. Well, a couple weeks into the internship, I had a tax intern come to me and say, you know, this is what I thought I wanted, but it's just, it's not a good fit for me. So at that point, we went back to the other person and said, okay, would you still be interested in switching? Because we've had this happen. And they were, so we worked it out with the partners that they were working with where they did switch out. They each did 4 or 5 weeks in one and then 4 or 5 weeks in the other. So through that, just that open communication, you know, they could have gone through, both of them could have gone through, not said anything, thought, oh, this isn't for me, I'm going to do something completely different. Ended up, the one who started an audit started full-time in tax the next year, the one who started in tax started full-time in audit the next year. So it does work out. It's a matter of maintaining those lines of communication and being honest with yourself about what you want.
Excellent. Thank you, ladies. And just from a format standpoint, what both Julie and Elizabeth have done is they've prepared to share some information with you in one of four categories. The first being before the interview and some things that you need to be preparing to do before. Second one being during the interview. Then third, after the interview. And then finally, once you've landed the internship or the new job as you launch your career. So what we'd like to do is allow each one of them to share what they want about that particular section and then open it up for questions, and then we'll move on to the next section so we can make it very interactive. So with that, I think, Julie, you're going to talk about before the interview?
I'm going to go first. Yes, I'm going to go through that, and I've asked Elizabeth to chime in along the way if she has anything she'd like to add. Before I start, just a quick show of hands, how many of you have gone through a formal interviewing process on your campus? Okay, good. So those of you who have will have some great scenarios and things that you might want to put on the table for some discussion or questions later on. And those of you who haven't, hopefully this will really help you, you know, kind of take the edge off the nerves and such and feel more prepared as you dive into it. So I'm going to start talking now about before the interview, and I've kind of broken it into some stages. The first is figuring out what positions and what companies you want to apply to, and there's a lot of different things that you can do to help you zero in on that. I would just first put out there, take advantage of the resources available to you on your campus. You all have career services centers for the most part, and they are the pros at this, and you should take advantage as much as you can of everything that they have to offer. They'll give you a lot of great advice and a lot of direction on how to get started and what to do along the way. But career fairs, information nights, different things that companies sponsor on your campus, you should try to get to those for anybody that you think you remotely might have an interest in, and talk with them about what their opportunities are, and then sort of process that against what you're interested in so you can really zero in on what might be a good fit for you. As you start to figure out who you think you're interested in and you start to think about applying, you need to understand for each company, everybody has a little bit different application process. So the Career Center can help you with that, but now most everyone has something that you have to submit online, and there may be other things that you need to do. And so you want to make sure that you cross all those T's and dot all those I's so that you're positioned to be selected in an interview with that particular company. you'll have lots of things to think about. Elizabeth referenced, you know, interns that couldn't decide if they wanted audit or wanted tax, and in our environment, with an accounting firm, that's one of the big major choices to have to make. So you do need to understand the opportunities and make some decisions about what path you want to go down. And that's hard because you don't always understand exactly what's involved, exactly what those opportunities are about, how they differ from others. And the best way you can get that information is by talking to people who do it. And that, again, means getting to every event on your campus that these folks are hosting and meeting people who are living it and doing it and talking to them about what they do. What do you like about your job? What do you spend most of your time doing? And just really good information gathering for you directly from someone. In most cases, they're bringing back folks who are recent grads from your school. They were in your shoes not too long ago, and they can really relate to what you're going through, and they can be great sources of information. So you need to really try to leverage that to help make your decisions. One thing I'd throw out there, so you might get advice on, well, you know, you should always tell the person you're talking to that you want to do what they do, or you want to be in their office, because that'll help you get an in. That might be true, I guess, a little bit from a political standpoint if you want to play the game, but my advice to you is to be honest and communicate with folks about what you're really interested in. As a recruiter for 14 years, my goal was to get the person matched to the right place, and they're going to help you do that. And if you're giving them information based on what you think they want to hear instead of what's important to you, you're not going to end up where you want to be. So I would just encourage you to have a really open and honest dialogue about what you're interested in, what city you want to work in, all of those things. A couple things on preparing a resume, and you know, that's something you could talk about for a couple hours, so I'm just going to hit a couple highlights, and if there's other things, you can bring that up in the questions. You want to organize it to highlight your qualifications in the order of relevance to that employer. So what I mean by that is, we're an accounting firm. We need people that are going to be eligible to be CPAs. When I look at a resume, the very first thing I'm looking for is if the student's an accounting major and they're going to be eligible to sit for the CPA exam. So that's me. That's my top thing. Other companies and other industries might have another top thing. So as part of that research, you're trying to figure out what that is, and you want to make it visible and easy to find because that's the first point of screening for an employer. So something to think about there. I'd keep it on one page. I know you guys, you're here because you're active and you do a lot of things, so you probably have a lot to put on a resume. But at this stage of the game, you really need to try to keep it to one page. If you're in a situation where the employer is printing hard copies of resumes for the interview process, page two will get lost. It's happened to me several times. And everyone's kind of stretched for time. And so when someone's preparing to talk to you, it needs to be concise and one page that they can, you know, get a quick glance and have a good understanding of what you're doing. So one page. No typos goes without saying. There's lots of things that spell check doesn't catch. Hand it to somebody who hasn't seen it at all and ask them to read it cold for you is a good thing to do, because a typo on a resume tells an interviewer that you're not paying attention to details. So just save yourself that grief. The other things I would say is about your experiences. And your career services folks will tell you this too. Try to use action-oriented words to describe what you've done in your positions. And, you know, maybe you worked at the corner, you know, ice cream place, and you're thinking, that's not really relevant. All I did was make ice cream cones. Well, you did a lot. You did a lot of things with customer service. You may have had ideas around ways to make a process more efficient. There's lots of things that you can share about, you know, that little summer job making ice cream cones that would be relevant to a potential employer. You just need to think through the way to kind of sell the experience and what you brought, the value that you brought to your employer, because that's going to be important to another new potential employer. I would make sure when you're doing like an email address or something like that on the resume, if the one that you have right now is something like partygirl@yahoo.com, open a new email account. So you want to have a professional contact that they can use. You want to use something that you can check regularly so that you can be responsive. And then just to take the kind of social media step down the path further, companies' policies about things like Facebook and, you know, other social media sites differ. It's becoming more and more popular to take a look and look at what's out there. It is not part of our formal policy right now because it opens us up legally to a lot of things. But I would encourage you to be careful about what's out there, not only what you post, but what other people might post about you. And even if an employer doesn't use it as part of the interviewing process, a client, you could go be introduced to a client, and a client might pop on and Google you, and then there's something that a client's seeing. So you've probably heard this from a lot of sources, but I just want to reiterate it because it's important. How am I doing on time? Couple more quick things before I get the hook. Once you are, you know, you're zeroing in on who you want to apply to, you've got your resume ready to go, now you're ready to start sort of the networking process to get to know those employers better. So I would encourage you every time, again, that they're doing something on campus to be there and meet with those folks and become a known entity so that by the time you get to an actual, you know, your initial interview, you've met folks from this company a couple times. They know who you are. That will definitely work to your benefit. You can also, going back to the social media aspect, LinkedIn is a great way to build a professional network and have a professional profile out on the internet that's different from some of the other things that you might be in. Definitely would encourage you when you meet someone on campus, you know, ask them, you know, Can I add you to my LinkedIn network and start building your network that way? You will be surprised at people that you will meet 10, 15, 20 years from now that you originally crossed paths with through campus interviews. You might not have gone to work for them at that point in time, but people just keep turning up, sometimes like a bad penny, but you never know when they're going to turn up and when, you know, having them as part of your network might come in handy. They might be able to help you with something, you might be able to help them. So I would encourage you to do that. Couple quick things about preparing for the interview itself. If your career services office provides the opportunity to go through a mock interview in a practice setting, you should absolutely take advantage of it, even if you already are feeling pretty comfortable, because the second thing I would highly recommend is practicing answering interview questions. And not just going through and reading the questions and writing down what you think your answers would be, but actually saying it out loud. Either having someone ask you the questions and you say, you know, your answer and get their feedback, or even if it's just standing in front of the mirror and saying it out loud, because it's a lot different when you try to verbalize it. And you need to verbalize it effectively with the interviewer. So there's lots of resources to get practice questions. Again, career services, but there's lots of different internet sites. I know we have it on our site, on our student site, within our career corner. There's lots of, you know, typical questions that represent the types of things that we would ask. And we were talking earlier about, you know, what really is a hard interview question, what's a stumper? And the reality is, if you thought about it beforehand, there's not really a stumper because you're prepared and you know how to do it. But if you go in cold and you haven't done a practice ahead of time, that's when you're really going to have trouble. So one last thing, back to my friend and my example. You should think about how you're going to get to your interview. Have a backup plan if you need it. Have a friend with a car or somebody that can get you there if, you know, the weather doesn't cooperate. You know, you're probably going to somewhere you're familiar with if you're on your campus, but if you're not, if you're having to meet at an off-site place, make sure you know where you're going, like a practice run to make sure you know how to get there, and where you're going isn't a bad idea, because the last thing you need is to add to your stress by, you know, getting lost and not being able to find where you're going. So I'm going to stop there.
All right, any questions on things related to before the interview? What questions do you have? Now come around with the mic. down to April and then Tyrone.
I don't have a question as much as a comment. As far as like researching companies beforehand, like before you go into interviews, kind of like even like putting them up on Google and like Googling PricewaterhouseCoopers and saying, you know, what are their awards, what are their history, that type of thing. How extensive would you say that needs to be as far as like if they ask you a question like, oh, have you heard about this program or this program, this award, or, you know, what do you think it would be really impressive if you said, you know, if you were to answer a question and throw something in there as far as like an allusion to something that was in the company's history? Like how important do you think that is?
It's important to have a good base knowledge of the company, definitely before you go into the interview. It's sort of interesting, though, because I've had like partners and managers comment sometimes after an interview. They can tell the difference between if you did a quick hit and like tried to pull a few quick fun facts so that you could throw that at them versus that you really tried to understand what we do. So if you said, oh, you know, I saw that you thought you're a big thought leader in this area, there was a new publication on this, how's that impacting what you're doing with your clients or something like that, is a lot more, you know, kind of substantive than if you were like, oh, you know, I saw you offer training, or I saw you got this award, you know, just something that's more showing that you have an understanding of the business and how, you know, the direction that the company's going or what their focus is or their strategy is probably more beneficial. Do you have anything?
I would second that, I think, in that you want to focus on something that you're really interested in so that you're genuine when you're asking about it. I will say with Deloitte, we've always got, you know, 500 different initiatives. You may throw one out there. If you just know the name of it, likely, or 50% of the time, I'm probably not even going to know what it is. I'm worried about what I'm doing day to day. So, and I'm worried about the ones that are important to me. So we can definitely tell if it's something that you're interested in and whether we need to follow up on it for you if we don't know about it.
My question is related to resumes. How would you incorporate something like what we're doing on your resume? Because it's something that's definitely worth mentioning to future employers, the fact that we were chosen to come here. But how would you incorporate it into your resume?
Yeah, absolutely. You all want to make sure that you get this added to your resume immediately. Space permitting, or you have to kind of think about how to organize this, but under some sort of extracurricular or like an honors and awards section, you can highlight things like this. This might be where you would put, you know, if you're a scholarship recipient or if you're a member of an honor society, or, you know, this would go right in there that, you know, you were selected or you're awarded a scholarship to come and participate in this program. Most definitely. And you would probably even want to go on with a short kind of blurb around, you know, highly selective 20-some students from across the country attend, you know, something that for, you know, most interviewers might not be familiar with what this is. So something that you can do to emphasize that it was a very selective, you know, kind of high profile group, but absolutely put it on there.
So something that I've seen a lot more of is phone interviews. I know that I've been seeing that a lot with some of the interviews I've had and some other students at our school. And I was just wondering, how do you prepare for a phone interview best when you know that you're not going to be like face to face with somebody? What kind of environment would be best? What kind of notes can you have? Is it appropriate to have laptop open to be able to continue researching? What are your thoughts on that?
My first advice would be to not do what I did earlier today when I was trying to host a conference call. So I didn't do a good job of finding a good place, and I didn't factor in that cell phone reception might not be great here. So you do want to find the right environment. you want to, you know, try to reduce stress as much as possible. So find a place that's quiet. If there's other folks around, make sure people know that you need them to keep quiet. It's not a great time for someone to run through with their dog or, you know, whatever. You know, so you got to get people to cooperate with you a little bit. Get a phone line that's going to be reliable. You know, cell phone, okay, if you get great service and you know it's going to work for you. But if it's not, or there's a chance it could cut out, make sure that you're using a landline. I would advise against having the computer open. I don't know how you feel about that. I just feel like that would be a distraction a little bit, and it would be really hard to focus completely on the conversation. And so, you know, I think it would be best to maybe follow up on something later. You know, if they ask you a question and you are feeling like, oh, wow, I really wish I could research, there are things that you can address, and I'll talk about this when I get to after the interview, but you can always address it in, like, a follow-up note or something like that to show that you took the initiative to track down information. So you don't have to feel like you know everything at that moment. And if you don't, it's best to be honest. But I'm trying to think what else would be relevant for a phone interview. I don't like to do them. I try not to unless there's some logistical issue that makes me have to do them. I much prefer meeting people in person. But I know with people trying to cut travel costs and things like that, it is happening more. I guess there's pros and cons. You don't have to worry about your interview suit. But but you do have to find the right spot and quiet and be able to focus and concentrate. Do you have phone interview?
I've done some, and I will say I like them better than I thought I would, because you look for the same things, you know, besides the appearance. You don't have to be nicely pressed, but you're still looking to build this rapport with the interviewer. You know, they want to know that you've done your research, know the answers. So a lot of that you can get across on the phone just as well as in person. I do prefer the personal. I think most of us do. And another thing that you may start seeing, which I really am not a fan of, is the video interviews. Those are awful for both ends, I think. So did that answer your question? If it works for you, then go for it. But yeah, I have to admit, I work from home, and there's another person who does it in my office also, and she's like, every day I get up, I get showered, you know, get ready just like I'm going to work, and then I go sit down. I'm like, yeah, I walk in there, and it may be, you know, 5:30 in the morning, but I sit down and start working, and I take my shower about 10:30 or so. So it's up to you. If it makes you feel better and more professional, go for it. If you're fine without it, then don't worry.
Well, Elizabeth, that's a great segue into the interview conversation. So why don't you go ahead and share your thoughts there?
It is. So my section is during the actual interview and what to do during the interview. Whether it's phone, video conference, or in person, your main goal of the interview is to sell yourself and why you're going to be a good person for this job. Now, having said that, you also want to be yourself. So don't go in there and try to pretend you're something you're not. And I know, like I was saying before, I think it goes without saying that you're not going to make things up and that sort of thing. But you want your personality to come through in this interview, because these are the people that you're going to be working with if you get the job, and you want to make sure that your personality goes well with theirs and that they like you for who you are. So be yourself, but be your best self, and I talk about openness and honesty. The interview is a place to contain some of that, but you don't want to be too honest in certain things, and I think you guys know what I'm talking about, so they don't need to know what you did last night and all that stuff unless you did something really impressive. So what Julie was talking about, the biggest thing for this interview is preparation. So you've gone in, you've researched the company, you, a big piece of it is figuring out what are your stories, because a lot of these, you know, these behavioral interviews, you can use the same story to answer about 15 of the questions. So make sure that you've thought about that, you've got two or three of those at least, and that you have gone through and practiced them out loud. I'll tell y'all about my first interview, which was on campus with PwC, actually. And I walked in there, and I felt like I knew my stories. I'd written them down, and I felt pretty good walking in. But as soon as I walked in there, I froze up. It was like the interviewer was somebody I hadn't seen before on campus, and she started asking me questions, and whatever I was trying to say would not come out right. It was terrible, terrible, traumatic experience. So I think I could have avoided that by actually practicing it out loud first and making sure that I had my points ready to come out of my mouth for whatever she said. It got better from there, thank goodness. That was my, I guess, my toss out one. I hate that it was a good company, but it worked out in the end. I did get offers and everything. So the next point of that is prepare. When you get in there, relax. If you're prepared, that'll help you relax. You guys, by the time you're in that position, they've seen your resume, they know what you do, and you're obviously there for a reason. So don't worry, don't feel like you're not good enough. Whatever your story is, it's a good story. The other thing I would say about that, though, from the story perspective, I don't know that I've ever made a hire simply from somebody's answer to a question. You can lose it that way, but most of the time you're not going to win an interview that way. And the way you do that is by building this relationship and by getting along with the person in the room. So how do you establish a connection? One of those ways, if you do know who you're interviewing with before, do a little research on that person. Well, you're not under any legal obligation not to Google them, so Google them. At the same time, at a minimum, you kind of want to know where they go to school, do they run marathons, or, you know, things like that pop up. I wouldn't, if somebody comes into an interview and starts spouting off about what I did last weekend, I'm going to be a little concerned. So don't let them know that you've done all of this so obviously. But sometimes you'll have that in the beginning, know who you're going to interview with. When I did make it to an office visit after that disastrous first interview, I walked in and they gave us these little bio cards for everyone that we'd be interviewing with. This was before you could Google anyone, so it was very helpful. And one of my guys, he was normal, you know, wife, two kids, a dog, whatever, and it asked for hobbies. One of his hobbies was pig calling. And so I'm from Alabama, so I do know the proper way to call a pig, but he was, okay. Just kidding there. I don't. But so I'm like, okay, either this guy really is into pig calling, which I kind of doubt, or else he's got a sense of humor. So we got through the interview. He's asked me all the questions. We've talked about a couple things, and he asked me if I have any questions for him. So my question for him was, so do you prefer suey or hear piggy when you're in your pig calling? And so he laughed, and, you know, it was something goofy, but it broke the ice enough where it did help our conversation. And it was funny because I got that offer and got that job and went to work there. And like the next year, it came up that was how I got the job, that was the thing that made me stand out, was that silly pig joke. But so you don't know what it is, and you've got to read your interviewer. But if you can find out little things like that about their hobbies or fake hobbies or whatever, you can establish that and really get to know the people and see if there's somebody that you want to work with. The other thing, well, a couple more things on the interview. I talked about being relaxed. Don't be too relaxed. While you all are great and everything, you're not, I don't want to say this meanly, but we've seen a lot of great people. So, and pretty much everyone who comes to work for us is great. So we want to make sure that you're a good fit And part of that is don't come in there and think that you hung the moon. You know, you're new and have a lot to learn, and just recognize that coming in. And I'm sure none of you would do that, but I have seen it happen, so I'll throw it out there. Another piece of this is this interview is a great chance for you to learn more about the company and the people. So when they ask that, do you have any questions? I think you've probably all heard this, but you better have some questions, because otherwise it looks like you're not interested. And frankly, I don't know how you couldn't have questions. One I always ask, because I really do care, is what does that person like about what they do? So if you're asking that of everyone, you know, I asked one of the partners I work with, and I've worked with him for years. I asked him that the other day. I'm like, okay, so I know you know, and I had been reading, had my head in the tax code for a long time. So I'm like, why do we like this again? And he told me that it's because in his case, it's problem solving, and he's being there for his clients and all of that. And when I talk to my staff people, it's because they're, you know, getting to work on these great companies and work with such smart people. So I like asking people that, because it gives you an idea of what, you know, what it is they enjoy and if it's something that is important to you. I think that's it. Did you guys have questions about the interview process? I think I forgot something.
Actually, it's a little bit of what you just talked about. Was I've been in a couple interviews where it's not where they're asking you straightforward questions the whole time, and where it's more of a conversation. I've had the opportunity to ask them a lot of questions during the interview. Mm-hmm. So then at the end, I'm kind of like, oh crap, I already asked them all the questions I thought about asking. And I, like you said, like, you don't want to look bad. Do you think that would look bad if I was like, I think you guys answered everything I already asked? Or would that make sense, or would it make sense to try, you know?
Well, you hate to ask something that's just clearly
pulling at straws or something.
Right. Yeah. But at the same time, it's good to keep one on the back burner. That might be a good one. Mm-hmm. What do you like about what you do? If it's been something that's been back and forth like that, and you have been asking a lot of questions, then no, it's not going to look bad at the mm-hmm. end of it if you don't okay. have something.
And then the other thing was kind of just a comment on your pig story was the last interview I had was I happened to mention when I was, they asked me to tell more about myself. I mentioned that my family was in the restaurant business, and so it turned out one of the interviewers used to own a restaurant. So I kind of started asking questions, and I did end up getting that position. So it does definitely help to try to make those personal connections.
If I could respond to the question, one thing that I've always advised students to do is to prepare 6 questions going into an interview in one of 2 categories. I'd prepare 3 for each, one category being something about the company and some of its initiatives, and the second one being about the position itself. And so you could follow, your standard question could be a part of the company. What do you like about the company or the industry? But then about the position itself could be some things that you found based on the job description or what you know about the internship. But the reason I would recommend 3 of each type is maybe 2 will get answered during the interview and you still have 1 to fall back on. But I think it's really impressive if you have good quality questions about both the company and the position. I wouldn't ask 6 if none of them come up, but make sure that I ask 2. In every interview.
I attended something like this at school, and the person doing the panel had said that the last question you should ask is, are there any doubts that you have about me being a good candidate for this job? How do you feel about a question like that?
I don't know. I wouldn't want to answer it. I mean, you're really putting this person on the spot. So it goes against my style. I think it is, again, it's kind of reading who you're talking to. If you've gone through it and you've got this great conversation going, something like that might kind of kill it. But, you know, you've got to make the decisions while you're in there. And what are your thoughts, Julie?
It is a little tough because it does put them on the spot. there are people that coach people to ask exactly that question. One thing that you can do is maybe get at it in a little softer way, like something like, do you have any advice for someone like me? How I might, you know, what can I do to make increase the odds that I'll be successful in getting a position like this? And that kind of plays it, to your question that you suggested, playing to the person's sort of ego that you want to know about them and what they think is never a bad thing because you are trying to make that personal connection and that you value their opinion. So I would say maybe go at it a little softer, sort of trying to get to the same point, but phrase it in a way that might not come across as abrasive. I don't know.
I wouldn't want to be walking out of an interview where the last thing on their mind were the doubts that they had about me. You know, you want to walk out on a good note. So I respectfully disagree with
One other thing too, as far as dressing for an interview and dressing for the company you are interviewing with, like I know, like I, for instance, interned at a sports management company in Denver, and everyone there was jeans, and I dressed up for the interview, and it was like they appreciated it, but it was kind of like, okay, are you really gonna fit in here, honey? Like, come on. So how would you recommend, like, kind of feeling out the company, and if you haven't been there, and if you don't know what sort of environment the employees work in, how would you maybe suggest kind of reaching that? Obviously, for accounting firms, you know, like the ones that you work at, it's gonna be a little different. It's a little bit different standard. You know, for me, I'm a hospitality management major, so I had a lot of different levels of restaurants and hotels and companies and that sort of thing. But how would you approach, or how would you suggest, like, kind of approaching that?
If you're comfortable with the interviewer and you do know that person, just ask them. Another thing I would do in that case would be call and ask the receptionist. Ask, you know, get somebody in that company to give you an idea. Because you hate to walk in there blind. You can always, I guess you can go stalk the office and if you've got the time and it's close by. But really, I think calling is the best way. And people are usually very willing to help on things like that. Everyone wants to give advice.
The other thing, this may or may not work, but if there's someone else who graduated from your school who works there now, that's a great person to reach out to. And they're going to look out for you and maybe serve in sort of a mentoring role because you're going to have that common bond of your school. So career services can help you connect with an alum who maybe works at an employer that you're interested in, and that's a great source of all kinds of information.
All right. Any other questions about during the interview? All right. Well, we'll move on to after the interview. Oftentimes, if you're sitting the fence, what you do after the interview could really tip you over to the positive side. So I think Julie's going to talk about after the interview.
Yes, I am. One thing that I would recommend that you do is that you send some sort of thank you correspondence to your interviewer. The folks aren't always in their office that they can regularly get mail, but they are all connected to email these days. And so this is a trend that sort of changed. It used to be that you would never, never, never send anything but a hard copy or a handwritten note. But most employers are sort of starting to get with the times. And so an email is okay. It'll get with them, you'll get to them in a much timelier manner, but it doesn't hurt to follow up with a hard copy note or even a handwritten, you know, thank you note card. As long as it's well written with appropriate grammar, it's legible, and there's something that you need to be careful about, because I don't keep a scorecard or a grid to say, okay, Susie sent me a thank you note. Oh, Johnny didn't. Okay, I'm not going to hire Johnny because he didn't give me a thank you note. So I'm not keeping track, but it can work to your benefit if you do it well. So if you write a note that makes a reference specifically to something that you spoke about during the interview, which helps bring you back to the interviewer's mind, oh, that's right, we had that great conversation about that. Boy, she was really sharp. So that can work in your benefit. What can work against you is a thank you note that's poorly done. So when I thought about some of my unique experiences that I might have shared when we started things off today, I was going to use this one, but it's not unique, unfortunately, because it's happened so many times. I can't tell you how many thank you letters I have received addressed to me. Dear Julie, thank you so much for your time last week. I really enjoyed talking with you about opportunities at Ernst & Young or at KPMG or, you know, one of my major competitors. Okay, so that thank you note gets filed in the round file, and that person is out of play. And that sounds harsh, but it is competitive. We do talk to a lot of great people, and we're putting those great people out in front of our clients, and we need them to pay attention to details. And that person didn't pay attention to details. So I know that sounds really brutal, but that can be a breaker. So you want to make sure that you do things that help your cause, and it's really not that hard to double check that and make sure that you don't do that to yourself. So make sure that you do. Making it personal, too, demonstrates your ability to build relationships, whether that's with clients or with coworkers. So that's another reason it's good to do that. I know you had a session already earlier today about communicating effectively. You really do, in this case, need to know your audience. You need to know the best way to communicate with that person. It might be that you want to make that one of your questions as you're wrapping up the interview to say, is it okay if I follow up with you in a week or two if I haven't heard from you? Is it okay if I follow up with you if I think of questions, that I didn't get to ask you today? Put the question out there so that you get permission to reach out to them and then ask them how they would prefer that you contact them. Is it okay to email you? Should I phone? That sort of thing. And you really do need to be careful about the language that you use. Most of the senior people in companies that are making decisions are still trying to get comfortable with the idea of texting and all the things that you guys do without even thinking about it is still very foreign to them. And so you really need to be careful about not using all those abbreviations or short and, full sentences, grammar, all of that kind of thing is really important. Once you get a little further into the process and you've gone through the interviews and now you're at the stage where you're going to receive an offer to go to work, I wanted to just talk a little bit about some things that happen in that process. And I would encourage you just to be, again, really honest as you're talking with an employer when you're trying to compare offers and you're trying to decide what are really the things that are most important to you to choose one employer over another. I would encourage you to talk about those issues with everyone that you're considering. So if you have offers from three comparable companies, just hypothetically, if you talk to one and they're telling you about something that has you sold, you're like, oh, that's the best thing I've ever heard of. I so want to work there. Done. I'm going to take their offer. I'm going to turn everybody else down. If I'm over here and I'm this third company and you haven't come to talk to me about that issue to say, hey, I just became aware of this one item that is really important to me and I wanted to find out, what do you guys do about this? Or do you have something similar? If you don't ask, I don't have the opportunity to tell you what we have to offer in that area. So you may end up, going with that first company may be great. It may be a good decision for you. But if you don't have the conversations across the board with all the employers, you're shortchanging yourself and you don't have all of the information to make maybe the best decision. And I guess I'm bringing that up because that's kind of a pet peeve, or I guess I just don't like to lose, but I've had it happen several times where there'd be a student that we really want to hire, we've got an offer on the table, they'll call me up and they'll say, I've decided to go with another firm, you guys were great, you were great, I loved everybody I met, it's just that they have this program where I'd get to go, I can go overseas in a couple years and I can work over there for a year and a half, and so I decided to go with them. Well, we have a similar program. We have more people doing that than anybody else. So if they would have told me that that was important to them, I could have explained everything that we have in that area. So it's challenging for us as an employer because there are so many things to talk about as far as the opportunities that we have and the different career paths that you could follow and the benefits and the programs and the flexible work arrangements and different things that you can't possibly go through all of it A to Z. So the dialogue afterwards and really talking about what's important to you and understanding and, you know, being honest and open is important. It's also important too, though, to not try to play the employers off of each other or try to sort of stretch the story to try to leverage a situation to improve an offer. Because, you know, we're not allowed to talk to our competition about those types of things because of antitrust laws. But, you know, we figure out if we're being played off of each other because we run in the same circles. We see each other all the time. An example I was giving Elizabeth earlier when we were talking is one of my schools, there were a ton of students that were always wanting to get to Chicago. Well, there's a lot of demand for Chicago, so it's really tough to get students from that particular campus to Chicago. And so there was one student that we could offer him in a different city, but he says to me, oh, well, you know, I don't want to go there because the other firm got me to Chicago. Well, I know that that firm isn't getting people to Chicago. So when I saw that recruiter, I'm like, oh, you guys got the doors open in Chicago, huh? And he's like, well, what are you talking about? And I said, you know, so-and-so said you sent him to Chicago. We couldn't get him to Chicago. So, you know, it's a small world, and there's all kinds of scenarios like that where an employer might run into somebody that, you know, works at a company that you had on your resume, and they'll say, oh, I interviewed last week somebody that interned for you. Conversations can happen, facts can get checked just informally without, you know, even trying to go down that path. So you just want to make sure that you're very honest in your negotiation process. I guess the sort of next phase then is once you've decided and accepted an offer, I guess I would say one other thing. Be honest and just have a conversation. Don't be afraid to call the recruiter that you're turning down for an offer and communicate. There's nothing more frustrating than the student who, as soon as they've decided, but they haven't told us that they've decided yet, kind of falls off the face of the earth, and they're not responding to emails, and they're not answering phone calls, and we can't get a hold of them, and they're sort of in denial. They just don't want to communicate to us that they've made a decision that we don't want to hear. So as I said earlier, you never know when you're going to cross paths with these folks again. Whether it's, you know, you walk in to interview with a new company 10 years from now and there's that person sitting at the desk, or you go out to meet a new client and there's that person that's going to be your client contact, you never know. So you want to treat people the way that you would like to be treated, and communicate openly and just be honest and just say, I've made a decision to go somewhere else. I appreciate everything you've done for me, but I think this is the best decision for me. That's all you have to say. You don't have to go into anything else, but you do owe it to them to communicate and not dodge them and, you know, kind of be afraid to have the conversation. And as you're meeting those folks, you're building those relationships and you're forming what can become mentoring relationships. And those are the folks that can help you with things like your work wardrobe, because you need to, you know what to wear. Well, you don't want to spend a lot of money on work clothes and then, you know, have your situation show up and figure out that you just bought all the wrong stuff. So, you know, building that network and starting to form those mentoring relationships will definitely help you prepare to be more successful once you start working.
All right, excellent. Questions for after the interview?
I had a question about negotiations. After you are kind of going through this interview process, and when you are comparing companies, how aggressive can you be within a negotiation before it becomes a turnoff for an employer? Do they want to see a little bit of assertiveness, or are they looking for you to kind of take your hits as a first-time employee and then work your way up from there?
That's a little tough to answer because we, and you guys are probably the same way, we're in a very structured environment when it comes to entry-level salaries. So they get set across the board, and there's really not a lot of room for negotiations. And so we do want to hear about, you know, if we're off the mark from what others are doing, we want to hear about that, because if we need to go back to the drawing board and make an adjustment for everybody, then that has happened on several occasions. So you should communicate it, but you should also understand that depending on the company's approach, what they've offered may already be their best offer, and you need to kind of take a step back and look at all the other aspects of the opportunity and evaluate that. Because, you know, in our environment, you come in at that rate the same as everybody else, but then from that point on, everything's performance driven, and it's up to you as the individual for where you end up. So you may start at the same place, but 2 or 3 years from now, you could be at a very different place from some of your peer group. So there's a lot of other factors besides just the compensation that may help you decide, you know, what would be the best fit for you. In other cases where, you know, a company might have a little more latitude, I don't think there's anything wrong with, once you have the offer in hand, you don't ever want to talk about money or compensation before you have the offer in hand, but once you have it in hand and, you know, you're talking with the recruiter or HR person, whoever it is, I don't think there's anything wrong with saying, I have an offer from another company that's, you know, this much higher and they're offering me this. Is there anything that you can do to help, you know, kind of make that, take that out of the equation? You know, is there anything you can do to help meet that? Do you have any?
I would say there's so much out there, so much information out there now for jobs that you should know going in what a reasonable offer is going to be. And if you're getting something outside of that range, I would definitely ask for more. Within that range, you've got to weigh it against the other factors. I mean, I think if it is something maybe outside of our very particular industries, if it's something like that, you can go in and it's not going to hurt. You know, as long as you're reasonable about it and you're not asking for double what they're offering you. But especially with ours, I just think as far as starting salaries go, $5,000 here or there, while it may seem like a lot now, isn't much in the scheme of things, and it's not something you really need to base your decision on. So go ahead and ask if it feels like the right thing to do, and do your research on the particular company and industry before that to know if it's the right thing to do. But if they say no, think about if it's really worth it for you.
Yeah, I know you guys on your campuses are hearing a lot about salary negotiation, and I know that's part of what you hear, but in most cases, the majority of that work happens after the first job out of college. Once you start, as these ladies have expressed, there's a template that's already in place at most companies of here's what it is, and they may have a slight amount of flexibility, but not very much. Moving forward, that's when that comes in. Great question, though.
When you do ask for more compensation and the company isn't able to accommodate it, is that a deal breaker? Like, do you two have to part ways then, or can you accept the lower offer? That
I think you can always go back and accept the lower offer.
Okay.
I think the key is what she mentioned is that you don't even engage in those conversations until you have the offer in hand, and then you can do that.
Yeah, a lot of it's how you approach it too. Mm-hmm. So if you're like, I got this, can you meet it? And that's it. You know, that's sort of I guess abrasive is a good term to use, but if the way that you're approaching it is, I'm really impressed with everything I've heard about your company. I'm so excited that I have this offer. Here's where I am. I just got an offer from another employer. I'm trying to compare the two opportunities. Their base salary is X much higher. They're offering me this, they're offering me that. Can you walk me through your compensation structure and your benefits to help me evaluate the opportunity? I'd really like to come with you, but I feel like I can't sell myself short when they're offering me more money. Can you help me get there? So, you know, that kind of thing.
Just as another follow-up to that, what kind of questions can you ask about advancement opportunities? Because in some cases, your first-time job might not be the career choice that you have for X amount of years, but in the case that you would like to advance within a company, how can you phrase that? How much does the person giving you the offer actually know about those advancement opportunities? And is that a good thing to understand before?
Yeah, hopefully that's come up over the course of the interview process. And if that's not on your list of things to ask your interviewer and it doesn't always already come up, that might be something to talk about, even if it's just asking that individual person, how did, you know, what was the career path you navigated to get into the role that you have now? You know, or how do, yeah, that's probably a good way to go at that individual person. But hopefully over the course of meeting different people who work for the company and doing your research, you understand what the possibilities are, and you've been able to ask along the way, this is of particular interest to me. You know, I think I might really do well in this area. What advice do you have for me to be able to, you know, take the right steps to get there? Those sorts of things. So I would say along the way, usually the person giving the offer, for us it might be a partner, or it might be an HR person, they might be able to answer that question, but definitely somewhere along the way you should have been able to get to somebody who can talk to you about career paths.
Great. Let's take a few minutes to talk about, now you've been successful, you've gotten the internship or the job and you've started, what are some of the things to be mindful of the first few days or months on the job?
The way we typically do things is you do, you know, we'll hire you in for an internship, and then assuming things go well and you don't really do something horrible, you get hired on full time. I say that, people kind of laugh, but it happens not a lot, but it usually happens out of every other intern class. Somebody does something that's just so idiotic that we can't hire them full time. So it's easier than you think, I guess. So there are a couple things to think about when you're in your internship. The goal of this internship is for you to get as much experience and learn as much about the position and the company that you can. So when you're in there, you need to be thinking about how do I accomplish those goals. In the office, I think one thing that happens, maybe not in every industry, but in accounting sometimes, you'll get in there and you'll go through your trainings and everything, they'll send you back to your desk and you don't have anything to do. So how do you go about getting something to do, and what's going to make you stand out while you're there? I would say the first thing to do is go around and introduce yourself to everyone if you haven't already met them, and tell them that you're, you know, that you're interning and that you're excited about the job and want to know if they have anything for you to work on. And you do that every day until you get something to do. And in the meantime, you do whatever there is. You know, if it is making copies, I spent my first 2 weeks working in the tax processing room where we went through and did, you know, put sign here stickers on tax returns and punched holes and stuff. So you do anything that you can, and you do it with a good attitude. Deloitte just got a new CEO, and he has this story about how he first started, and there was one other guy that started with him, and it was late 60s or something like that, and he was getting paid $11,000 a year, and he was all excited about his first job. And he got there, and the task for the two of them, they were responsible for making coffee, making sure that there was always hot coffee in there. And he said that he would go about, you know, he would go do it, and he was like, the other guy was complaining about it, and I can't believe this, I've got a college degree, why am I making coffee every day? And he went in there with the attitude of, they're paying me $11,000 to make coffee. So, which was evidently a lot of money at the time, or a decent amount of money at the time. So it's all, you know, it's all about your attitude and how you go in there. So what happened is people saw him in there and he was all excited about making coffee. So he was somebody that they wanted to work with. So he got put on jobs sooner, and now he's CEO. So you go in there with a good attitude and you do whatever you can to show that to people. My working in the tax processing room, I'm not CEO yet, but the tax processing people still love me. It's still the same people, and if I turn something in late, they'll stay late to do it for me. You know, so you, whatever you're doing, there's something that you can gain out of that, and you just need to look for that when you're doing it. The other piece, so that's kind of what to do when you're in the office. The other piece of your internship is what to do outside of the office. So a lot of times during internships, we do Braves games, and you know, we do all these things for our interns, and they're happy hours and all of that. So you need to know how to act in those things. I think that it is very important that you do those things. One of the things that you're doing is trying to build these relationships. So I would say whenever you're invited to something after work, unless you've got something where you absolutely can't do it, you need to go. Go make friends and talk to people. Couple caveats from that. Who is under 21? Go, but don't drink. Do not drink. You put the firm at risk. You know, I realize whatever you do in college is your own business, but when you're there at a work function and you're under 21, you do not want to get the company sued because you get arrested. Another thing, if you are over 21 and legally drinking, know your limits. You're out there, you're having a great time. I've got a rule. I call it the three-place rule or something. I got to come up with a better name. Always go to the first place. If you're invited out to something, always go if you can. Second place, you know how these things go. You're out having fun, and everyone's like, okay, now we're going to go over to this place. If you're having fun, you're making friends, you're still sober, go. Third place, never, never, never go to the third place. Bad things happen, and people lose their jobs. Don't go. You will see them again. You'll have other opportunities, but do not go. So that's, if y'all remember nothing else from this, remember that. So let's say you've done your internship. You've gone in there. You've had a great attitude, made lots of friends. Come down to the internship, and you get the offer. So now you've got to make the decision, is it really something I want to do? Really look at yourself at that point and make that decision then. Don't just do it because it's there. Think about, is it the right thing for you? Is it the right fit? If it's not, if you feel like, you know, I love the people, but I just not crazy about what I'm doing here, that's when those relationships really come in handy. So you go back and you talk to your recruiter and you say, I love the company. I really want to work here, but I really don't think I want to do this every day. There are so many other positions, you know, even within one company, there are usually other positions. So they need to know about that before you go out and start looking on your own. If you could do that and there's really nothing there, then if you've done all these things, people will be happy to work with you. They want, like we were saying about it, it's a small world out there. It is such a small world. And you remember the people that did terrible things, and not even terrible, but you remember the people that wrote the bad thank you note and that sort of thing, but you remember the people that did a good job. And even if they don't want to do what you're doing, you want to do everything you can to make sure they end up in a good position and hopefully maintain that relationship. So.
Great, great. Any general questions about either after you've landed the opportunity or anything else that we've talked about this afternoon? James?
All right, I have a question about after you've already had an internship. I work at a public accounting firm right now, and there's a possibility I would want to move out of Albuquerque after graduating. The internship's going to last until I graduate, but I know, like you said, a lot of people get internships at these big fours, and then they get offered a full-time position based on the internship. Say, is it unethical for me to look for another internship, say, with one of the big fours while I already have an internship with a public accounting firm? How would I really approach that?
I would say the way I would approach it would be to talk to somebody about it. I mean, I think unless there's something wrong, public accounting firms in general are going to have a lot of similarities. Unless you've seen something there that just makes you say, I don't want to work at this firm no matter what, you're going to be better off if you go through those channels and you've already built those relationships and they're going to recommend you to people. we can, you know, we can send people to different offices. We can let people do different things. It's one of the great benefits about public accounting is there are so many opportunities.
Is that there's a chance, like, I work at Moss Adams, and it's a West Coast firm. Mm-hmm. And there's a chance, you know, it's, they obviously don't have any firms on the East Coast, and say Chicago or New York or something like that. Obviously, I can't just work my way up and then go to a New York office through Moss Adams. That's why.
Yeah.
Based on something like that, how would you say I should approach that? Or if
I would still, I mean, if there are people there that you don't, there's got to be somebody there that you trust to talk to. I would go talk to that person. And if you're going to move anyhow, they would rather have a hand in that and get you to somebody, you know, to a friendly firm or something like that, where then when you decide you want to come back, you'll come back to them and you've got that relationship. I mean, they aren't, up until you reach partner level, nobody's going to hold it against you for so right now they want to keep you happy and do the right thing for you. Generally, it's, as an intern, it's not important enough for them to, you know, to lose one intern to bother messing up a relationship or a partner.
And James, network with the gentleman back there in the back of the room from New Mexico as well. He may be able to help you.
He can help. Yeah, exactly. Very small. I was just going to kind of echo what she was saying. Talking with someone, you don't know what relationships might exist with the folks that you are working with right now. You know, they can pave the way. They might be able to pick the phone up and call somebody they used to work with that works with a firm in New York, and, you know, they could become your best ally in the process. But through having the open communication, I like what I've seen here. This has been a great experience, but I really, you know, you don't have the opportunity that works for me because of things outside of your control. I really need some advice. Is there anything that, you know, and then that person becomes your ally instead of you being in a very uncomfortable and awkward situation.
Great. We're running out of time, and I want to take maybe about just 60 seconds to just kind of summarize some of the things that that we've heard today. And then I would recommend that you stick around a few minutes after the session closes if you have some other questions for our panelists, as long as they have time to stick around. Let me just say, just when we talked about before, there are a couple things that came out that were nuggets. One is that you need to use your resume to help differentiate you as a candidate. One way to do that is to use action verbs versus listing responsibilities. You can use action verbs, and that gets you more into the accomplishment standpoint, as well as using relevancy as a way to order your resume, so things that are relevant to the company that you're interviewing with. Also, think through responses to every question. It was recommended that you maybe have a couple stories that you can use to illustrate certain examples. There ought to be key messages that you have that you want to make sure that you communicate, and figure out what those are and practice for those beforehand as you go into the interview session. Also, it was recommended that you go out and take a look and maybe do a drive by a day in advance. I would recommend that if your interview is at 2:00 on Thursday, if you have an opportunity the week before, drive at 1:00 so you understand what the traffic is like at 2:00 on Thursday. If not a week before, maybe you do it a day before, but practice your pattern there, as well as practice for the interview with someone, or even, I think it was recommended, maybe you practice sitting in front of the mirror so you have an opportunity to do that. During the interview, remember that that's an opportunity for you to sell yourself, but you need to sell your true self and be yourself as a part of that. Fit is critical. If you've gotten to the interview, they've seen things from a credential standpoint on you and other people that they're interviewing, so really what they're trying to identify is who's the best fit for our environment because you meet the qualifications already. Establish a connection with the interviewer. It was recommended that a way to do that is by looking at Google. Another way to do that is to look around the office and see things that you may be able to connect with. Maybe it's family pictures, maybe it's some hobbies or things that you see there. Be kind to the people around you, even the receptionists and the people that are in the administrative role. Oftentimes the key decision maker will ask, you know, how did this person treat you? So treat those people with kindness. That's also a way that you can get information about the dress code or other things that, that come out. Use the interview as an opportunity to learn more about the company to see if it's the right fit for you as well. Then after the interview, one of the things that was mentioned was to send a thank you letter, but make sure that that thank you letter is one that's going to enhance your opportunity to land the position and not eliminate you from it. I interviewed someone about a month ago. He was, in my mind, right on the borderline. I just couldn't figure out if I wanted to hire him or not. He sent me a thank you letter. Before I opened it, I said, yes, this is the guy. When I opened it, my name was misspelled. And I thought, I know the last thing I did was give him a card before he left my office. And so for me, that was just a lack, a total lack of attention to detail, because he had my card. That's how he got the address. Why couldn't he get the name right? And it was grossly misspelled. So again, it's just an example there. It's not an easy name to spell, I know. So reference the conversation in that thank you letter so it can bring back a good memory. Ask for permission as to how to follow up and utilize that, and use professional language as a part of that conversation. If you're leveraging, or if you have multiple offers, don't use those offers to leverage each other, but be honest and authentic in your conversation with the companies and make sure that you are not only getting the best opportunity, but understanding that opportunity in totality. Don't just zero in on the dollars, but look at the total offer in terms of the other benefits that come in and make sure that you're comparing apples to apples. Remember that the internship is an extended interview, both for you and for them. And so utilize that as an opportunity to network, look for ways to get more work, and remember that your attitude when you're doing that work will help determine your altitude within that company. Not only the hire, but this is a great example of how the CEO started off making coffee. And his attitude in doing that helped open up opportunities for him to move forward and beyond. So just the key in the internship phase is to build relationships, but build the right relationships by being very participative, both from a work standpoint as well as in the opportunities to network after work. You do those things, you continue to ask questions and engage in conversations with professionals like these ladies. Let's give them a hand and thank them. You put the appropriate amount of work with it and you're on your way to success. So thank you guys for letting us spend the afternoon with you.
I think we need to give them one more round of applause. Thank you.